small RAF repair depot of 1939, providing Spitfires for the Battle of Britain, became enormous, at the heart of the great American contribution to World War II. It went on through the Berlin airlift, the Cold War, to its closure after the Gulf War. Now, for the visiting Americans, there's so little of the base left to see as to make it barely recognizable. Just as the base itself grew, so has the Burtonwood Association. From a handful of both British and American members 15 years ago to over 1,000 now. They first arrived as young servicemen and women. Now they come back, these Army and Air Force veterans, bringing with them a fervor to preserve memories of their time in England. What's different now is that within 2 years, all tangible signs of the friendly invasion will be gone. This week of visits, destined to reverberate with recollection, will be the last one to take place here.
Is that the base?
Good grief.
You don't remember it, huh?
It didn't look like that when I was here.
So I remember they used to have a service club used to be there.
That's right.
A little commissary, I believe, and the PX.
Yeah.
And a bowling alley, too.
The bowling alley's still there.
I remember going in there.
Yeah.
What happened? When did they pull down the infirmary? I was a nurse there.
That's George Pritchard. This is Joan Rogers. They got married. They have, I think, 3 or 4 children now that all live in the United States. This was Peggy Rogers, her sister. This is me, Tom Connolly. George and I dated these sisters for about a year.
We were just kids. It was an adventure. It was the prime of our life. We had a great time.
And I worked in the propeller shop, which was right there.
Yep.
Those were the engine testing.
Engine test. Yeah, they used to keep us awake all night.
Oh, yeah.
Yep.
Well, they didn't have those anymore.
No.
But this was just a group picture of flight test personnel.
That's Connolly there, isn't it?
That's Connolly, yeah.
I think so.
Yeah.
Where's Tom Connolly?
Well, he should be in there then.
Red Johnson was in flight test section.
Well, the high point of my life, and it's been downhill ever since.
The Americans transformed a modest RAF maintenance unit into a mighty operation.
It was decided because it was near Liverpool and away from the weight of the Luftwaffe's bombs, it could make a good American maintenance base. So the Americans came in 1942, developed it to become the headquarters for the maintenance and support of not just the aircraft, but the ancillary equipment as well for the whole of the 8th Air Force in the UK. During World War II, it just grew and grew and grew. They extended it constantly. They built a new runway. They had enough living accommodation on site for probably about 10,000 people, and about 8,000 lived off-site. They put through 11,575 aircraft in 20 months, just a vast number of aircraft. It became the gateway to Europe for all the American Army and Air Force personnel. It was the glimpse of Europe that most of them had.
Time since I've been here. I wouldn't recognize the place. 55 years.
Mostly it's all changed.
Oh, yeah.
What do you expect in 47 years?
You look right up there, you'll see a B-17 was painted on the wall in World War II. Probably some maintenance or mechanic, or maybe even an armor done it. We don't know. But it's up there. Of course, it won't be there too long now, because this building's scheduled to be destroyed.
Burtonwood was stripped bare whilst playing its last role in the Gulf War in 1991. By then, a gradual dereliction had already given way to wholesale demolition. It was clear that the hopes of the association members for a permanent touchstone in the Northwest were to be dashed.
It's very sad to say. We've watched it slowly, slowly come down. I can remember seeing all the buildings standing and then slowly watching them being pulled down, photographing them being demolished. It's very, very sad indeed.
It was a time capsule. Everything had stood still, and then gradually a local firm was brought in to knock everything down. We did try to save things. We even tried to save the control tower, but I think once the powers that be got wind of it, Fred Dibner was in and down it came.
Oh yeah, there's
the runway.
There it is.
Yep, there's the old runway.
There's the old runway.
It's a nice road now, huh? All the cars are landing there.
They feel like they're coming home. If you're on the coach with them, they say, "Oh, there's so-and-so. And do you remember so-and-so?" And they still reminisce about which gate they went out and which hut they slept in and that sort of thing. And you see, there'll be no memories. There'll be no place for memories when they come back.
This will go there, all right? Okay, all right.
Can't make it. Joe, hey, you want a hand here? Oh, there, okay, oh, come on, young fella, get in there.
Yeah.
Atta boy, there you go.
The sad part is for those people who do return specifically because of the Burtonwood Association, there is so little left for them to identify, and it's very difficult to really form an identity anymore without any physical signs left. And as the housing developments occur and what little bit is left of just the open fields disappear, then even more so there'll be no identity left.
Do feel the regret we should have some kind of memento or monument there for all the people that passed through Burtonwood.
Keep the memory. Let people know what happened. Don't try to just erase it.
Among the 8,000 who lived off the base, Howard and Kathleen Hawkins. The last reunion here gives them a chance to revisit the old neighborhood 45 years on.
Hello, my name is Howard Hawkins. I lived in this house from 1956 to 57.
Yeah.
And we just thought we'd come back and see how it looks.
We rented this house. Did you win?
In 1956.
56.
September.
When we got married. We got married.
56 to 57.
And had our reception in this front.
In here?
Yes, in here. And then.
A bunch of other GIs.
Mixed up
here
our.
In the other room in the kitchen.
I was born whilst we lived here.
Oh.
And I used to keep her outside the front door. And I want to tell you what I remember about it. Well, I have many happy memories, but polishing the red doorstep and the brass that was in this house.
Thank you again for inviting us.
Pleasure.
Very
pleasure.
Nice. Thank you very, very much.
No trouble at all. Okay, everyone, this way.
In World War II, Walton Hall was also taken over by the US Army. Warrington sees the expanse of Burtonwood as space for future housing development. But there's a determination that the heritage of those who served there will not be forgotten.
A very warm welcome to Walton Hall and to Warrington. This, in many ways, I suppose, even for those of you who meet regularly, is a trip down memory lane. Sadly, of course, Burtonwood, as you knew it and loved it, is not quite the same as it was. And as you know, it is in fact going to be built on very shortly. Your welcome will be as warm whether Burtonwood is there or not.
I see the mayor of Warrington drives a Jaguar. Our mayor drives an old Ford.
You know what I did? See, I was 18 when I got here.
Yeah.
One of the first things I found was a 19-year-old girlfriend. And we did get married.
Welcome to Pa Hall here in sunny Warrington. Thank you.
Statistics suggest that one in four GIs from Burtonwood married local girls. From their arrival in 1942, it certainly didn't take long for the Yanks to descend on the pubs and dance halls.
Americans to the British were either gangsters or cowboys, because that's all they saw on the silver screen. And so they were glamorous. And all of a sudden, they were here in Warrington. And the first ones were civilians from San Antonio in Texas in cowboy gear.
They were wearing big hats and boots, and I can imagine the people here in Warrington say, oh my God, what have we got here, you know?
When we first saw them, we just saw these people with the helmets on and things around the legs and these big armbands on.
MPs.
And we didn't know who they were. Yeah. And it scared us a bit. I said, it looks like the Germans have arrived, because things were getting a bit bad then. Because of the, well, just before that, I was bombed out.
Suddenly, these guys were in town, the jitterbugging extraordinaire. They were really, really good at dancing. And so these guys were really, really attractive to the ladies, which was very, very understandable.
I can remember literally arriving in on Burtonwood assignment on a Saturday afternoon, and that evening going into Warrington. And I can remember the first pub we went to, the Pelican, and immediately up above it on the second floor was a dance hall called the Casino Dance Hall. And within 24 hours of arriving in the country, I was introduced into warm beer and lovely English women.
Went to the Holy Cross Hall in St. Helens, and we're all dancing, and the door opened and all these Americans came in, and they all stood around the walls and they didn't do anything.
Of course, you know, young boys are going to go look for girls. So we went into the dance hall, see what it was like. And I spotted her then. And from the bar, we could see them inside, so I kind of kept my eye on her, and I think she had her eye on me too. But I asked her to meet me outside, so I asked her what her name was, and she didn't hesitate, she told me. So we made an arrangement to meet at to Marks and Spencer's the next day.
So he said, well, I've got two friends. And I said, oh, well, I've got two friends that I work with, Beryl and Joyce. And she said, do you think that they would come and meet us? And I asked them, and they said they would. And we all got together. Beryl married a man named Jonesy from Alabama, and Joyce married Jean from Georgia. Yeah.
We reckon that 7,500 ladies from the northwest of England married Americans from Burtonwood. They started off in 1942 and they continued right through to 1993. Relationships sprung up everywhere. Parents tore their hair out, and girls were kept indoors. You must not go out, you mustn't go to these places. But there was this, an incredible bond which happened almost instantly.
All of us, and my friends as well, we all went on the same boat, the Derby, to America. And it just all sort of worked out. You know, it just worked out.
Everything just worked out good, you know.
At its height, Burtonwood was like an American town with a dollar economy. It had several schools and its own hospital facilities, including the maternity unit for the whole of the US military in Britain.
I was an Air Force nurse posted to Burtonwood. I arrived in the last day of April 1951. It was probably the best time of my life. We had the absolute best staff of nursing, British nursing midwives that I have ever. I mean, I just couldn't think enough of them. What they didn't know about midwifery was not worth knowing.
Corporal Andy Cangiano was a newly married airman at Burtonwood. He and Norma haven't met for almost 50 years.
While we were here, we had a child. And Norma was the nurse that 47 years ago delivered or helped deliver my child. One of the reasons I came back was to obtain this beautifully handwritten birth certificate for my daughter.
I've got it.
And there's another legacy of the American invasion. It's estimated that hundreds of babies were born to GI fathers who returned to the States without marrying. Now there's an increasing desire from these grown-up children to explore their American roots. For Elaine Hazeldine, it all started with a determination to discover her father.
In 1986, I happened to be given a newspaper address in San Antonio, Texas, and I wrote off. The next thing, there was a phone call. So I went to the phone, and this person, which turned out to be one of the four sisters, asked me, had I placed an ad in the paper looking for this person? So I said, yes. She said, well, he is your father. The next thing she said, well, he has died. He died the year that I started the search.
Since then, Elaine's been helping others. Each of them has found it an emotional and rewarding experience.
Well, you're all supportive to one another, aren't you? You know, you can understand one another and the situations that they've been in, you know. You hear some stories and it's as though we're all the same, but different stories to tell. Your life does change, you know, through it all, because it's a family that you've never known and you've never had in that respect. It is a wonderful feeling knowing that you've got somebody out there. It's nice, it's a complete feeling.
Burtonwood was relatively safe in wartime, far from frontline action. But for the reunion, a visit here to Madingley near the old American bomber bases is especially poignant.
I can't comprehend all that happened. You have to come and see it for yourself. It's pretty sad.
I had three brothers in service for a long time, and they all came home and during World War II. But to stand over here and look at this wall and see all those that didn't come back, it's just almost more than sometimes you can feel like you can bear, you know.
The sweet used to
to be. That was once you and me. Keeps coming back like an old melody. The perfume of roses in May.
All the B-17s, all the 24s, the A-20s, the B-26s came through Burtonwood.
They'd come in 100, 125 at a time and circle the field and land two at a time.
It was an adventure for a bunch of kids.
You keep coming back like a song.
The people that were involved in Burtonwood were involved in it in a very important period of their lives, when they were young and impressionable, reaching young adulthood. In most cases, it was the first time any of them had been away from home. And not only are they away from home, but they're in a foreign country. And in the cases of the World War II vets particularly, it was very important to them because of the wartime atmosphere and the uncertainty of the war, and obviously because of the time in their lives.
The colonel came up one day and he said, "We need you overseas." So, you know, I had a family and I wasn't particular about going. Basic training we done day and night, you know, trying to get us over here, and we got over here. I ended up at Alconbury, and I flew five missions, and when I landed, they in a 17, yeah. And when I landed, they told me, "You're in the wrong place." And they said, "We need you more in Burtonwood." So back to Burtonwood. And that's where I stayed until December 45.
Most of them came out here not voluntarily, but they were told, "You are going to Burtonwood, like it or not." They came out here hating it. A lot of them left it hating it. But when they looked back on it, they loved it. They had a great time.
They had assembly lines that take an engine off of an aircraft, put it on the assembly, take it apart completely, replace all damaged parts, worn parts, put it back together, bring it back, put it on an airplane, and then we'd slow time them.
Wonderful to be able to bring people together and get friends who haven't seen each other for years, in some cases 50 years, and we can get them together again, possibly for the last time ever in their lives. It is something special to them, which they will never ever forget. And I think it's very important that we should keep the memory alive, and that is a whole reason for being, is to keep the memory alive of what happened at Burtonwood. And I think it's important that people know and remember.
I imagine some of you felt a sense of loss in 1993 when the base closed. Now you're facing another finality, the obliteration forever of the site that brought you to England and brings you back for these reunions. So I guess there is some sadness as you meet this year and a sense of loss. because it's probably the last time the association can meet on site, as it were. What you have that truly matters will endure forever. It isn't, nor ever was, the base and its buildings, the planes or equipment that was of value. Rather, comradeship and cooperation, loyalty and love, the companionship and community you built together. They were then and are now of lasting value. Almighty God, we pray for the Burtonwood Association and for this week of reunion, celebration, and remembrance. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
They came here, they took over Warrington, they did a huge amount of work, and then they went home and got on with their lives. They came here as boys, they left as men.